Mina, konbanwa, JesusFreakinGamer here. This Sunday topic is going to be really heavy. This involves something incredibly personal to me in my life, something that I plan on talking about eventually, not this quick into my YouTube career, for however long that career lasts, but because of recent events, I thought now may be as good a time as ever, since people are looking into this topic, since people are talking about it, to enter into the public foray and to express another opinion, another viewpoint. You know, hopefully it won't get lost in the middle of all the viewpoints. Hopefully people won't think I'm simply, you know, trying to grab views and grab, you know, grab income and grab subscribers and all that stuff in the middle of all this. I won't deny I want income. I want subscribers. I want the YouTube thing to kick off. It'd be a lie to say otherwise. I've said that in my extended intro. I want this to be a career. I want this to be profitable. The primary goal, however, as I've also stated, is to spread the name of Jesus Christ and the way Jesus Christ forgives sins, heals all wounds, and can change the worst person into a decent person. In fact, one of the best persons. So, in light of the rape allegations surrounding Toby Turner, I figured I would tell my own story. Now, no, Toby Turner did not rape me. I have nothing involved with him. I don't know him. I'm not accusing him of anything. And in regards to the story, it was actually Boogie who he spoke about this for several minutes. He did a vlog on this, and it resonated with me. So I was like, you know, now's probably a good time for me to share just a little bit about me, let you guys get to know me a little bit better, a little bit from where I came from, and it's something in my life that's ongoing. So to cover the Toby Turner thing real quick, because people are accusing him of rape, and of course there's really no evidence to absolutely convict. There's probably no way this case can go to court because there's no, since it's been so long, there's really no proof that can be turned into the court. Therefore, it may ruin his career, possibly, but probably won't face any jail time, even if he is guilty. Not saying he is. I have no idea. But these allegations usually come up years later at a time when nothing can be done, true or false. So having said that, and for you, those of you who are looking for an opinion video on Toby Turner, you can tune my video out now, hit the dislike button for false advertising. But yeah, that's all I have to say about that. Because of such serious allegations, something did happen to me in my past, and I thought, now again, it's a good time to cover it because it's kind of on the public's mind. So I want to discuss something that I went through, and something that I had to overcome, and something that's still ongoing, and how Jesus can bring healing even in the middle of something really, really terrible like this. So on to my story. When I was really, really young, I don't know, 4 or 5, something like that, I was at my grandparents' house. My mom was a single mom. She married a man who didn't want kids. She wanted a kid anyway. Got me. Then at 2 and a half, they ended up divorcing because he found another woman and didn't want to be with my mom anymore. So she had to live with her folks, my grandparents. So, you know, I'm a little kid. She has to work, and they hire a babysitter. And the babysitter is not a nice guy. A very, very cruel and mean man. Abusive. Physically abusive. What I clearly remember is him always yelling at me, always very angry. There are two incidents specifically that I remember. One was he told me to stand in the kitchen for whatever reason. I'm sure I did something wrong. I was a brat. I will totally admit that I was not a nice kid. I was not a good kid. I had my fair share of whoopings, and I deserved pretty much every single one of them. I'll own up to that right at the forefront. Having said that, I'm in the kitchen, I'm just staring at him. I don't know if I was angry or confused or disappointed. I don't know what emotion was going through my head, but I know I was staring at him. And he noticed I was staring at him. And after a while, he ordered me to come back into the room where he was. So I went in there. He pulled my britches down, pulled off his belt, and said, "I am going to spank you until you ask me to stop." And so he proceeded to do just that. He spanked me with that belt. In my little mind, it was very hard. And he said, "You want me to stop?" And I said, "No." Spanked me again. "Do you want me to stop?" I said, "No." He spanked me again. "Do you want me to stop?" "No." And this happened over and over and over again. I was crying my eyes out. Hurt really, really bad. He's yelling right in my face. And eventually I cave in and say, "Please stop." And who knows how, I know it hurt incredibly bad. I know that's not how you properly discipline kids. And that was the end of that particular scenario, as far as I recall. Second scenario was much more unique. Again, I was being bad, doing whatever I was doing. And he told me to put my head into a pillow and not to take my head out of the pillow until he told me to. So I put my head in the pillow, and so, you know, I can't see anything. And at some point there, my mind goes completely black, completely blank. Consciousness was lost. You know, did I pass out? Did I fall asleep? I don't know. Fast forward to when I'm a teenager. This particular babysitter came up in conversation. And at that time, my mom said that when she went to bathe me after one of the days that he had babysat me, that my entire buttocks was bruised all the way down to around my anus. And my mother completely flipped out when she saw the level of bruising there. And because there was bruising around the anus itself, she told me that I had been raped as a child. So, obviously, she waited until she thought I was old enough to deal with that. And at the time she told me, I did know Jesus. Now, I accepted Christ into my heart as Lord and Savior when I was 13 years old. So she told me at some point after that, I don't remember when, at whatever point she thought I was mature mentally and emotionally enough to handle this. Now, as a Christian, we're commanded to forgive everyone for everything. Everything. Including incredibly vile things like murder and rape. Now, how justice plays into that, to go into that very briefly, people who commit sins of that caliber, and I do believe there are calibers of sins, I do believe that some sins are worse than others. I didn't prepare this verse in advance, but if you look into the time when Jesus was talking to Pilate, Google's your friend, Jesus said to Pilate that the Jews who delivered him over to Pilate had committed the greater sin. That word greater in the Greek is qualitative. It means like something, not greater in number, but greater in quality. In other words, the sin itself, it wasn't like they committed more sins, but the sin that they committed was greater. In other words, worse. Please look that up for yourself. Double check behind me. One of the biggest things on this channel is I want you guys to think about the things I talk about, the topics I bring up. I want you to engage, to be active, to be involved in your relationship with God and just in, you know, your own mental focus. So I had to forgive this man for raping me. That's not to say that rapists and murderers shouldn't be held accountable. I believe they should be held accountable to the fullest extent of the law and possibly even more than what United States law allows. I will not get into that. That's a topic for another day. But definitely punishable to the fullest extent of the law. Absolutely. That does not, once they're punished, that doesn't just excuse me for forgiving them and saying, yeah, that jerk got exactly what they deserve. I'm so glad they're suffering. I hope they get everything that's coming to them. It's an attitude. The attitude needs to be, I forgive them for what they did. justice needs to be met, and they need to repent of their sins before God. And they should apologize to the person that they've hurt. And that's a pretty blanket statement for all sins, whether it's just a simple gossip behind someone's back and you own up to it, or something as serious as, I raped you, or I killed a member of your family, and I'm sorry. It usually doesn't happen. It's not a perfect world. Perfect things don't happen. But that is what should happen. If someone becomes a Christian, they should fess up to whatever it is they've done, repent before the Lord, and apologize to the people that they've hurt, if any, in regards to their particular sin. So maybe because I didn't remember what happened specifically, forgiving him wasn't a big deal for me. I blacked out. I didn't remember the actual act of penetration. I didn't remember the act. The only abuse I remember was just severe beatings and a really loud voice yelling at me. That's all that I remembered. It's all I remember to this day. It's all I ever remembered. Maybe because of that, forgiving him was easier. So I just said, oh, I should forgive him. That's my Christian duty. Okay, Lord, I hand this man over to you. You do with him as you will, and I pray that you would save him, make him a Christian, and make him genuinely sorry for the sins he's committed. In Jesus' name, amen. I forget how long it took me to do that. I don't remember it being I don't remember it being as big a deal as, if a grown woman is raped and they were conscious through the act. I can't imagine how horrible that would be and how horrible a time that they would go through, because I'm not a woman and I wasn't conscious when the act happened. So I can't relate to that. My heart and prayers go out to those who've suffered something like that. Nonetheless, what I went through wasn't a small deal. What I went through was game-changing, life-changing, and it was something that I had to do. But I forgave him, never saw him again, and I moved forward with my life. Now, normally that would be the end of the story. Normally one doesn't confront their rapist. Normally that's not what happens. Usually the rapist doesn't come back to them. Once they're caught and out of the person's life, they usually don't get a chance to apologize. They usually don't care to apologize. They're usually put to jail, and that's the end of it. Or in the case of a child rapist, they'll either get busted, or a lot of the times they will get away with it and you never see them again. Well, several months ago, I actually ran into this man. I was shocked that I ran into him. I couldn't believe it. I didn't remember his face. I had to be told, yeah, this is the guy. I know the guy's name. If you hear your rapist's name, that's not something you're going to forget. So I had a chance to speak with him. And so what I determined in my heart is that I would confront him with what he did, and I would tell him he needed Jesus. If you think that's brave, thank you very much. It probably was brave. That was brave of me. But I saw it as my duty as a Christian. I need to hold this person accountable for their sin. I need to confront them with what they did. The Bible says, if someone has offended you, go to them with the offense. Now, that normally applies only between Christians. But something on this scale, I'm like, yeah, this needs to be confronted. This definitely isn't something that can just be swept under the rug. So I did. I confronted the man to his face. And first I confronted him with a physical abuse. He denied that. He admitted to whipping me, to disciplining me. And then he said he called someone else to come over and take care of me, because he knew if he didn't, that it would have gone really bad, because I was out of control and he couldn't contain his temper. Well, I told him, you didn't contain your temper at all. You didn't handle the situation well at all. You should have called that person much, much sooner than you did. And then I confronted him on the rape part, at which point he blew up. said basically, I never did such a thing. I never could do such a thing. How dare you accuse me of such a thing? I didn't back down. I pursued it and ended up, because of the circumstances in which it happened, I didn't leave the vicinity and neither did he. Several minutes passed, he cooled off, and he basically at that point said that I had been told, he actually apologized for blowing up at me, gave me a hug, and said that what I had been told was incredibly wrong, that he would never do such a thing, and such a thing never did happen, and that he doesn't know why my mom would make up that kind of a ridiculous lie. I ended up talking to a few of my friends, people who were involved with police, detective work, things of that nature. Because I wanted to see, hey, since this guy is still around, since I now know essentially where he is, what should I do? I confronted him as a Christian, and he denied all of it point blank. And you can imagine most people would deny having done something like that. They would try to weasel their way out of it. When I talked to my friends, and I gave them the details that I just gave to y'all, essentially what I was told was that, now the only evidence my mom had of rape was the severe bruising that I had. And she knew that, because I was that little, she was still bathing me. So the severe bruising that was on my bottom is what convinced her of what had happened. And she also told her mother at the time, my grandmother, and the grandmother said to not tell anyone. She didn't want the family torn apart now. That, strangely enough, it was a little bit harder for me to forgive my grandmom than it was this babysitter. Because I know my nanny. I loved her. I knew she loved me. I saw nothing but love. Why in the world would you hide something like this from anyone? Something that wicked and evil needs to be exposed. So I had a really hard time forgiving her for that. Something that I still think about very often. What my friends pointed out to me when I brought this up to them, they said a few things that surprised me. They said that if a little child is anally raped, there will be much more than bruising. There will be severe, copious bleeding, perhaps even hemorrhaging. For a grown man's penis to be inserted into the anus of a 4, 5, whatever your old child, boy or girl, the flesh simply can't take something that large. So there's going to be a lot of tearing. There's going to be a lot of destroyed tissue in the area. It will extend far beyond bruising. In other words, what happened was probably only a beating and not a rape. I never had reason to consider this because I simply forgave my rapist, never knew what happened to him, and I moved on with my life. I just assumed, okay, this happened. This was horrible. God loves me. He created me with a purpose. He allowed this to happen for a reason. Atheists love to tackle stories like this and be like, yeah, your God's, he's not very good if he allows something that horrible to happen. God does not, he doesn't override our free will. He does allow sin for the short amount of time that is called our present reality, Earth, from Adam and Eve to the present to the future when Jesus will come again. For this period of time, sin is allowed. All the way back to the book of Genesis, God allowed Cain to kill his brother Abel when there were possibly more than 4 people on the planet. We know Adam and Eve had a lot of children, but in theory, in possibility, only 4 people on the planet. And God allowed that to happen. He allowed something that horrible to happen. God doesn't limit our free will and prevent these horrible sins from happening. He allows people to do those things, and he will one day judge and punish the people who have committed those crimes. Cain was immediately punished with that mark. He was cast away from his family. Read the story in Genesis chapter 4. And a lot of people in this life, definitely not all, but a lot of people are captured and tried for the things that they do wrong in this life. And those who somehow evade the law, they'll get theirs when they stand before God judgment day. No one's avoiding that. So within that, I am content. I know that justice will be done in the end, even though it's not always done on the earth. And God does have a reason for allowing the things he allows, all the way from Cain and Abel's the murder and up into including the abuse that I went through. So having said those things, based on simply the damage that was done to me, that indicates physical abuse. Also, if my grandmother believed only to have, blah, if she only believed that I had undergone physical abuse, I do have to keep in mind, and again, my friends are the ones who pointed this out, that her generation back in the 30s and 40s, to whip your child to the point of bruising and even bloodletting was not uncommon. And I was a severely rebellious, self-willed child. Obviously, she wouldn't. The logic flows. There's no way she would put up with rape. But if she simply thought that a rebellious kid got the beating he deserved, that's not something that you want the family torn up over. You don't want anyone's reputation tarnished to say, well, this person's a rapist and a child abuser. You know, don't wreck the family over this. So, so from those two points of logic, it made me think, wait a minute, maybe my mom was completely wrong all those years. Maybe I forgave the man for way more than he ever did to me. Now, that in and of itself is a personal problem for me because I don't remember what happened. I was raised my entire life believing that this happened. And here I am now, a man in my 30s, finding out, oh, that thing you believed all your life probably isn't true. There's good reason to believe it's not. And while part of me is leaning to that's probably not true, there's a very strong part of me that still is like, you know, I might have been raped. That's still a possibility. That might have happened. Even though the evidence seems to indicate otherwise. I didn't pursue legal action because, well, one, at this point, there's no way to possibly pursue or prove anything. That's not even possible. Two, my faith in this man having raped me has pretty much been shattered. I don't strongly believe that. I'm leaning much more into it was physical abuse. I remember that, but physical abuse only. So I'm in the middle of what do I believe? What conclusion should I draw? Because I want to draw a definite conclusion and say this man did this or he didn't do this. I was raped or I was not. I want to draw a conclusion. And I'm finding it very hard to do so. And so that's a big, big chunk of my history, a big chunk of who I am, what's led me to this point in my life, what's helped to shape and to mold me for the better or for the worse at this point in time. Now, how all of this relates to Toby Turner, whether he did it or not, how this relates to the people who actually have raped people, to the people who have been raped, majority of them would be women, not men, although some men are raped as well. What I want to say to both parties is Jesus is the answer. That's the ultimate point of this video. Because of what Toby Turner did, rape is being talked about. I wanted to share this at some point in all of my vlogs and one of my sermons to let you guys, you know, get to know me, to address that everything can be solved in Jesus. Since the public eye and ear is on this right now, I thought this would be the best time to approach this particular topic and to dialogue about it. Jesus Christ can change you if you are a rapist. He can change who you are, and He can forgive you for your sin. He forgives any and all sins. If anyone's watching this and they are a rapist or a murderer, I want to let you know that Jesus actually does still love you. A lot of Christians wouldn't say that. If anyone watches this video, other than my friends, I might get some flack for saying that. But biblically, I know I'm right. There's no one that God doesn't love. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. That doesn't exclude anyone from the equation. If you have done something terrible that no Christian, you know, would want to talk about, if you've done something terrible that, you know, if people found out, they'd report you to the police and you would face life imprisonment or even the death penalty, God still loves you. And He's calling you right now. If you're watching this, He's calling you to repentance in Jesus Christ. To those of you who have been raped, I may very well not be one of your number, as I believed for so many years. I may not be one of you. And that should make me incredibly happy. And yet at the same time, I'm torn because I live the better part of my life believing that I was. So I should be happy that I don't join the number of those who have been raped. But I am still, as I've stated, conflicted and torn about what to believe there. But I want to let you know that God has healing for you, for your emotions, for your mind, for your heart. Jesus offers healing for you. And He does call you to forgive the person who did that to you. As extreme and as terrible as it was, you are called to forgive and forgive, just as your Heavenly Father loves and forgives. So to the rapist and to the rape victims, to both parties, I call for repentance and for a return to Jesus Christ. If you do wish to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you're willing to repent of the sins you've committed, again, either party, all humans have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23. So even rape victims, you haven't done anything that terrible, you have still sinned. For those of you who feel so compelled, for those of you whose hearts are reciprocating the message that I'm saying right now, you understand that you are a sinner, that you need to repent, accept Jesus into your heart right now. Don't wait another minute. Tell Him that you believe that He died on the cross for you, and that 3 days later He rose again from the dead. That you want Him to be your God, your Lord, and your Savior. And if you need a prayer to guide you, pray this prayer with me. Again, either rapist or rape victim. If you feel so led right now, if you desire to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer with me. If you didn't pray it a minute ago, if you need like a guide to follow, pray this prayer with me right now. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. That applies to both parties. One may be more severe than the other, but both parties are sinners. And I acknowledge that, Jesus, I need You in my heart right now. I believe You died on the cross to forgive my sins, and I believe You rose again on the third day to promise me life everlasting. Please come into my heart. Please forgive my sins, as dreadful and terrible as they may be. Save me. And thank You. I believe that You have, despite the things that I've done. In Jesus' name, I pray and thank You. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer, whichever party you're on, you are a different person. The old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new. That's another Bible verse. Google's your friend. Now for the big part, we're going to go a little bit over 30 minutes here, guys, because there are a few things that need to be wrapped up here. For those of you who have committed the crime of rape, if you just accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to let you know that your sin is forgiven, that you have eternal life in Christ, that God, He loves you one way or the other, whether you repented or not. But if you did repent, not only does He love you, you are now His child, and you will inherit heaven with me and every other person who's accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. Your sin's not so bad to keep you out of heaven. And if what I just said convicted you, go back and see the prayer that I just prayed. Go back and pray it. It's never too late. And if you watch this video and it just slips by you, then feel free to come back at a later date. God's love and God's offer of repentance applies to the minute before you breathe your final breath. You are always able to call on the mercy of the cross. And I would strongly recommend that if you did rape someone, that you do admit it to the police, that you do turn yourself in, man or woman, up to your crime, and admit what you've done, not only before God, admit it before man as well, and pay the earthly price. To those of you who are rape victims, I'll be honest, I don't know. I can't think of a site off the top of my head to give you where, you know, hey, go here, get help, talk to this person about what you've gone through. But I do know that what happened to you, you do need to talk about it. If you just talk to God, that is good. And if you just talk to Him to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are also one of the family. God's love and His mercy and His healing are extended to you, and He wants you to reach out for it with both hands. I would encourage you, though, don't just leave this at the foot of the cross. Please talk to a person that you love, that you trust. Tell them what happened. If this is something that's happened recently, please go to the police immediately and report this crime. The reason things turn out the way they do, if you come out with it years later, nothing can be done legally because you didn't pursue it, because you didn't follow up on it. It needs to be talked about immediately, not just to God and not just to your family and friends, but to the authorities. You know, report this guy. Give the details that you can. Let them take whatever samples that they need to take from your body. I know that's very, very graphic, but this is a terrible crime that needs to be stopped, and those people need to be stopped. For those that won't repent, for those that won't accept Jesus, they need to be stopped. For those that will accept Jesus, I hope they will not only repent, I hope they will turn themselves in and basically man or woman up to the crime that they committed. But for those of you who are the victim, please report this immediately. Do not wait. And do not just tell God, do not just tell loved ones. Go to the authorities with this. I wish I could think of some link offhand to give you to call with this problem. Maybe I'll Google one up and put that link in the description. If I can't find anything, Google is your friend. There are people that love and care about you. Get help. There is healing for you. There is restoration for your life and for your heart. This does not have to be the end for you. Do not give up. Don't end your life. Don't hurt yourself. Don't blame yourself. You're not the one at fault. Regardless of your age, regardless of what you think you could have done, it's not your fault. So I'm going to close the video up here. I'll try to find a link in the description for a place where you can go to get help if something horrible like this has happened to you. And so that's about it. Incredibly heavy topic brought up tonight. So that's about it for me. I love you guys very much. I love all parties that watch this video, and so does the Lord Jesus Christ. I love you guys, and God bless.